nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back to Unit 2 of our course. This is the third lecture. Now, if you remember, in the second lecture, we set up a little semi-classical model to guide us through the quantum model that we'll now be talking about. So if you remember, we are looking at a small range of energies. There is inflow and outflow from the two contacts, which you could write in the form of a differential equation like this. And at steady state, there is no dN dt, but there's a I1 and a I2. Those are the currents that you're interested in. Now, question is, how could we get a similar picture in the quantum model that is out of the Schrodinger equation? Because the Schrodinger equation as it stands does not have this inflow and outflow. Now, first point, as I've mentioned in the introduction, is that in order to see this inflow and outflow, you need to go to the time-dependent Schrodinger equation. And by and large, you are talking of steady state, so there is not much explicit time dependence that we'll actually be discussing. But in terms of understanding this current, occasionally in the next two or three lectures, we'll have to go back to the time-dependent one rather than the time-independent one. And as I mentioned, the connection between them is this time-dependent one, the psi tilde, has this exponential minus iet over h bar. And the way you get from here to here is by noting that when you take the time derivative of that quantity, it's just like multiplying with minus ie over h bar. And so effectively, you just multiply by e. And that's how you get this equation. Okay. Now, what we'll show is that, guess, if you add a term like this, that corresponds to this outflow. And if you add a term like this, that it corresponds to inflow. And where do we get these terms? Well, the direct way would be from the boundary conditions. That is, you say that the Schrodinger equation kind of applies everywhere, but we restrict our attention to this region and apply boundary condition on the two ends. And those boundary conditions effectively give rise to terms like this. But how you do that from the boundary conditions, that's something we'll discuss later in the course as we look at different examples. For the moment, all we want to do is understand how a term like this and a term like this gives rise to inflow and outflow. Now, in order to understand that, of course, the first thing is we have to know how to connect this number of electrons to the wave function. And as I mentioned in the introduction, the connection is that n is this quantity psi dagger psi. And in order to understand dN dt, the rate at which the number of electrons changes, what we need is the d dt of psi dagger psi. And what the Schrodinger equation, the time-dependent Schrodinger equation, gives us is the d dt of psi. So question is, how could we use this to find out that quantity? Well, the way you can do it is, again, the chain rule. So you have d dt of a product of two things. So you take the d dt of the first thing multiplied by the second thing, and then the first thing times the d dt of the second thing. Now, we want to replace this ih bar d dt psi from the Schrodinger equation. And here, there's three terms, so we can do it one by one. So if you put in all three, the algebra would kind of look messy. So we'll first put in the first one, see what we get. Second one, see what we get. Move on. So let's first look at the first term, the h psi. If you put that in, what you'll get is, this is psi dagger, ih bar d dt psi, you get h psi. Here you have psi. But here you now need the ih bar d dt of psi dagger, right? As opposed to ih bar d dt of psi, which means you kind of need to take the conjugate transpose of both sides. Now, when you take that's this dagger. So you have h psi here, so you got the h psi dagger. And the reason you pick up a minus sign is because when you do this conjugate transpose, of course, that only affects the matrices, the transpose part, but the conjugate part affects this I and makes it a minus I. And that's why you pick up that minus sign there. Okay. Next, what you could do is then note that H psi dagger is really psi dagger H dagger. So you have psi dagger H dagger psi, and then psi dagger H psi. So you could pull the psi dagger out in front, the psi at the end, and inside you have H minus H dagger. Now, one property of the Hamiltonian is that it is Hermitian. What that means is it's equal to its conjugate transpose. So H dagger is equal to H, and so this term drops out. So basically then that first term doesn't give you anything as far as d dt of psi dagger psi is concerned. And that makes sense because you see what H psi, this E psi equals H psi describes is an isolated channel. In an isolated channel, electrons cannot disappear, go anywhere. So there should be no dN dt. In fact, that's why fundamentally, when you are doing a theory of this isolated channel, you expect the Hamiltonian to be Hermitian, Hamiltonian meaning this H, to be Hermitian, and that's what is reflected here. Now, when you look at the second term, the sigma, the one that is supposed to cause outflow, the point is that one is not Hermitian. It is not equal to its conjugate transpose. But otherwise, you see, that term looks just like that. This is H psi, this is sigma psi, which means we can run through the same algebra, and here we would get a sigma minus sigma dagger, but now we wouldn't be able to cross it out and put zero. So what we'll get when you look at this term is an additional term here, which will be like psi dagger sigma minus sigma dagger psi. So that would be one of the flow terms there. Now, what about the S? Well, now you can do the same algebra, but now instead of I h bar d dt psi, you put in S. So it's psi dagger, and here you put in the S. Here it is psi, and for I h bar d dt of psi dagger, you put in S dagger, again with a minus sign, because when you take conjugate transpose, you pick up a minus sign there. So overall then, the I h bar d dt of this number of electrons is given by that term and that term. And what we'll see is how this is kind of like outflow and this is inflow. Now, moving on then, so what we have is this. Now, the sigma minus sigma dagger, as I said, this quantity sigma is not Hermitian, so it's not equal to its conjugate transpose. And the difference, you see, sigma minus sigma dagger times I is what we'll call gamma. So, as I said, this is, if sigma were Hermitian, this would have been zero. So if sigma were a number, then gamma is kind of like the imaginary part of that number. Of course, it's a matrix, so it's like the anti-Hermitian part of the matrix multiplied by this I, right? The way. Now, with that, what we could do is, we could write dN dt, that is, this is n. So dN dt is psi dagger psi, and of course you have to divide by I h bar, and then sigma minus sigma dagger you replace with gamma. So you'll then get an expression looking like this. And you'd get gamma, but note that, you know, sigma has two parts, sigma 1 and sigma 2. Similarly, the corresponding gammas also have two parts, gamma 1 and gamma 2. So gamma 1 is I sigma 1 minus sigma 1 dagger. Gamma 2 is I sigma 2 minus sigma 2 dagger. So that's this quantity. So this then becomes that after dividing by I h bar. And the last term, we just have it as it is, just divided it by I h bar. So this is then the expression for dN dt. This is what tells you the rate at which the number of electrons is changing, right? This is this inflow and outflow that I mentioned. Now, and that you can see by comparing with our semi-classical picture. So this one is kind of like the nu 1 plus nu 2 times n, whereas this second one is kind of like this, the inflow term. Except that right now, it's not quite clear how this looks like that. We'll have to do a little more algebra to get there. So that's what we'll do next. But the first one, I think, you see the correspondence, kind of. The gammas are like the nus. Now, note that, again, dn dt, that's what we equate with I1 plus I2. As I mentioned, for steady state flow, dn dt is actually 0. But when you look at the expression for dn dt, you'll find certain terms that involve I1, contact 1, and certain terms that involve contact 2. And that is how you identify which is I1, which terms give you I1, and which terms give you I2. And the point is the sum is 0. This is steady state. So what we'll do is, instead of dn dt, we write I1 plus I2 divided by q. So we have an expression like this. I1 plus I2 divided by q is equal to this term and that term. And as I said, the first one corresponds to the outflow in the semi-classical picture. The second one will require a little more discussion. Now, note that from the previous slide, I have now taken off the tildes. We are now back to the time-independent picture. We are not talking of dn dt anymore. We are talking of steady-state currents, I1 plus I2. And the whole thing is 0, but this part of it involves contact 1, that part of it involves contact 2. Now, next point is that you see in our modified Schrodinger equation, psi depends on S1, and you could rewrite it in this form, as I discussed in the introduction. This I, capital I, is like the identity matrix of the same size as H and sigma. So you could invert that to write psi equals the retarded Green's function times S1, gr times this. And you can take the dagger of that, the conjugate transpose, that gives you S1 dagger times the conjugate transpose of the retarded Green's function, which is called the advanced Green's function. That's this. So you have psi and you have psi dagger. And you could use these to replace the psi and the psi dagger in there. So instead of the psi here, you could write gr S1. Instead of the psi dagger, you could write S1 dagger ga. So next, we define, you notice you have a quantity here, GA minus GR. So what we can do is define a quantity, A, which is actually like the density of states. That's not obvious, though, but it's like the density of states. And this A is defined as I times GR minus GA. And if you write this quantity as A, then you see that term becomes S1 dagger A over h bar S1. So this whole thing that we had before now looks like this. And now I think you can see gradually the connection to this inflow term. So in other words, we have I1 plus I2 is the terms we had before, one involving gamma 1, one involving gamma 2. And we just considered a source term S1, and we saw the inflow due to that. Of course, as I mentioned in the introduction, it is a little tricky to put two source terms into the original Schrodinger equation, because if you put them directly in, you'll get interference terms that actually don't exist. So what you should do is consider only one source, get your result, and then add in a second source term. So overall, the picture is you had U psi equals H psi, then you have the sigma 1 psi and the sigma 2 psi that gives you the outflow, that is, those are those two terms, and then the S1 and the S2, they give you inflow, and that's these terms. And you can now kind of see the connection between the two, although this connection will get clearer in the next lecture when we write down the NEGF equations. But here you'll notice then this gamma over H bar is a little bit like this nu, the rate at which electrons flow out. And gamma has the dimensions of energy. So when you divide by h, the dimension is frequency, like per second, just like the nu. And here you have this S1 times density of number of states. This is also kind of like that. The capital S1 is like this S1 dagger S1. And the density of states is like the A in here. And as I said, we'll develop it further in the next lecture. But now the point is that overall at steady state, I1 plus I2 is equal to 0. But if you look at the terms that involved 1, then you could identify it with I1. And if you look at the terms that involve 2, you can identify that with I2. And total is, of course, adds up to 0. Okay? So, to sum it up then, what we discussed in this quantum model is how you start from the Schrodinger equation and then get these additional terms, sigma 1, sigma 2, and the S1 and S2. And if you look at the inflow and outflow by looking at this dN dt, then you can identify the inflow and outflow. You'll get an outflows that would look like the psi dagger gamma psi. That's like the new one N. And for the inflow, you have things like S dagger AS, which is kind of like this S1 D0. So those are the inflows and those are the outflows. So the main picture I wanted to convey in this lecture is how by adding these terms into the Schrodinger equation, and as I said, the way those terms come about is by considering boundary conditions, which we'll get to when we look at examples. But the point I'm trying to make here is if you have terms like this, they correspond to outflow and inflow, much like the common sense semi-classical picture. I mean, this picture, the semi-classical picture is to guide our understanding of these different terms. And with this picture, we'll go on in the next lecture to develop the set of NEGF equations. Thank you.